I'm Matt Wallace. I'm a Lieutenant Colonel in the South Carolina Army National Guard, and I'm currently deployed to European Command Headquarters as an operational law attorney. On 9/11, I was in the Greenville County Courthouse working on some cases. Somebody came in the courthouse and said that a plane had crashed into one of the buildings of the World Trade Center. So a lot of that day was spent just following the events and trying to figure out, you know, what had happened and who was behind it. And my job kind of went from a part-time job to eventually a full-time job in the National Guard. I got deployed in 2006 to Iraq. I spent 14 months deployed during that time. In some ways, put my civilian career on hold. In other ways, it's developed me professionally. I think it's strengthened us as a family, though. We look forward to those times when we can be together for short periods of time. We try to fill as much as we can into those times together, build memories, spend time together. And I think you really have a greater appreciation for those moments than you do when you have them all the time. You think a lot about your life. You think a lot about the lack of control that you have over your life and how things are in God's hands. Being with the soldiers during those times when we went on convoys, they were very young. They were 19, 20-year-olds who were doing these missions that were very difficult, very dangerous. And I remember, I remember the times where we'd have prayer before we go, and everybody in the convoy would get together and pray, asking God for protection during those times when we had to go out. And, you know, I remember thinking about those young people and how they had to do those things. I remember vividly one time we were getting ready to go out, and there was this 19-year-old specialist who gave me a safety briefing before we got into the Humvee. And she said to me that, you know, in case we get hit, in case I'm killed, you need to reach down here and grab this lever and release the seat. My body will fall. You can climb over the top of me and start driving at that point. So she just said it like it was part of the safety briefing. When she said that, I was like, well, okay then. I'll be sure to do that. You know, during those times, you really had to rely on God to be there and to keep you at peace. And you had to, you know, you just had to have a sense that he was in control of the situation and that whatever happened was his will. You know, that's, you know, trusting God with my family to protect them, to take care of them, to see them through those times has even been more difficult for me, I think, because I don't want to do it. I want to be there. And not being there has been very hard. So in those respects, you know, I think that it's grown my relationship with Christ, and you know, it's helped me be a better Christian and a better leader, a better spiritual leader for my family.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Jonathan Hamilton. Currently, I'm a Granville County Forensics Officer in Granville, South Carolina. On 9/11, I was actually employed by the Granville City Police Department, and I wore the road. That morning, I had just gotten off from working night shift and went home, went to bed, just like any other day. I was called by my wife, actually, who told me to run and turn the TV on because something has happened in New York. At first, I didn't think much about it because I didn't know what she was talking about. However, when I turned the television on, probably 10 minutes afterwards is when the second plane hit.
Jared Niske, firefighter with the Gannett Fire Department. I was actually off and at home in bed on 9/11 and had a friend call me and wake me up and tell me what was going on.
My name's Lindsay Painter, and on September 11th, 10 years ago, I was sitting in my fifth grade classroom, and we were working on our math workbooks. And I remember that an next door teacher, she'd come by the classroom and was talking to Miss Barnett about something that had happened. I know that Miss Barnett, my fifth grade teacher, she started crying, and she turned on the TV, and she turned it on right after the first plane had hit, first tower.
I was in my junior year of college, and I had a late class, so I was sleeping, and my mother called me first, and she woke me up, and she told me that a plane had hit the World Trade Center, and my first thought was it was a two-passenger small plane, and judging by her tone, she thought the same thing, and I was surprised, but it didn't have the impact that I had later. But then my sister called me, and she said that a plane had hit the World Trade Center, and then she said she was scared, so I knew that it was bigger than what I thought, and I left my room and found one of my suite mates sitting on her bed, and she was crying, and she was watching the news and everything that was going on, and then I saw what happened, and before I knew it, all of my suite mates and I were sitting there, and we were just glued to the TV, and none of us were speaking, and we were crying. And
Dean Waters, and distinctly remember exactly where I was at. I was at work at Oconee Memorial Hospital, and coming down a hallway during 9/11, when I turned the corner, I saw a group of people huddled around a TV, and I came up to them, and that's when one of the twin towers was hit by the airplane. And then, of course, as I was standing there, the second plane then in turn hit the other tower, and it was like a jolt at that time that something as magnitude is going on that day.
My name is Valia Warren, and on 9/11 I was attending high school at Elkhart Baptist in Indiana, and I was walking in between classes. I was actually headed to my economy and government class, and we had televisions in all of the rooms, so as soon as we knew that there was something going on, all the screens changed from the announcements to live news feed of what was going on.
My name's Joey Hall. On 9/11, I was sitting at my desk at work, oddly enough, working on a travel guide for New York City, and got a message through our interoffice email that something bad was happening in New York. And so, of course, a lot of us huddled around the biggest computer monitor we could find and started watching live news coverage of what was going on.
Okay, so my name is Nick Shaler. And on September 11, 2001, I was on active duty in the U.S. Navy. I was stationed in Pensacola, Florida. And we were in a secure facility at the time, so we didn't have any external comms or TV or anything like that, doing training. And one of the instructors had come in and said, you know, a plane had hit, you know, the World Trade Center. And my first thought was, oh, that's kind of strange. I didn't think anything of it. And then when the second plane hit the towers, the instructors would come in and notify us, you know, basically we were under attack. At that point, they had locked down the base, and we were sent back to our rooms, to our barracks. And then from there, you turn on the TV, you see both of the towers are on fire. Another plane strikes the Pentagon, and you're just kind of in shock. You really can't believe what's happening in front of you.
Right after 9/11, the support from the community, both from the community that I work in and from the church from Northgate and from the family was tremendous. And that was the one thing that kind of stuck with me from 9/11 is just the support and the love that everybody showed.
Without my vision, oh Lord of my heart, not be all else to me, say that thou art, thou my best thought, by day or by night, waking or sleeping, thy presence my life.
And I deal tremendously with post-traumatic stress disorder, and I'm a certified cognitive processing therapy provider, which is a form of therapy that we use to treat PTSD. And we have many veterans that come in where this anniversary is a trigger for them.
And I true son, thou in me dwelling.
From there forward, you're just always wondering, you know, what's going to happen today. You know, I feel like 10 years since that moment, it's a little bit different, but I remember thinking at first it was very much that way, where you thought, is today going to be a good day? Is today, you know, are things going to be okay? Is something going to happen today?
It made you as a law enforcement officer more apt to keep an eye out on things that you never noticed before. My family, you know, my children were young at the time, but my wife, I think that it was more closer because of what happened, because she came to a realization, I think, that you know, what I do for a living is dangerous, and you never know what's going to happen. You know, one day you're there, next day you never know what's going to be around the corner. So it made us look closer, and think more of our marriage and more of each other and how we can spend the time that we have the best we can.
Everyday living, just what you think about, you know, you don't know what's going to happen from day to day, and you just have to make what you're doing that day count.
Oh. I remember 9/11 being the start of a time when I probably, more so than any other point in my life up until then, I prayed more on 9/11 and in the 3 or 4 days after that than I ever have before. And I remember going home and just being so moved by things that I was seeing on TV, particularly the story about the other plane that went down in Pennsylvania and how the passengers on that plane had decided to take matters in their own hands and weren't going to let the terrorists decide their fate. They were going to go out on their terms. And I remember being very moved by all of that. And that was probably the first time in my life that I prayed sincerely for strangers and really felt it deep down inside.
You know, I know we've always heard you're not guaranteed tomorrow, but that just made it all the more real. And, you know, I'm thankful for what the Lord's placed in my life and where I am and what I have. And I just want to glorify Him with that.
You know, it really made me consider and think about, you know, like, why does something like this happen to people who are, you know, innocent? As a younger Christian, I would say, during that time period, it made me question, you know, my relationship with God. Why would something like this happen to these people? But God has His plan and He has His purpose. And, you know, it definitely brought me closer to Christ.
I'd say from a Christian's perspective, you know, you always hear, you know, God's in control, but sometimes we sit back and we think, why would something happen like this? But I think God's hand's in everything. I don't think that He caused that. I think that He is now working through that and has brought brought the nation together and churches together to develop plans and programs that can help with things like that. So it's more an heightened upon ourselves that to get our life right with Christ and to live in that and to help one another.
I struggled at first a little bit with that. I was strong in my faith then, like I am now. I did feel like I didn't understand why God would let that happen. You know, you start to think those things, and you know, then, you know, just the struggle of knowing that God has a purpose for everything, and in everything there's a, you know, there's a reason and a time for everything.
And as we hear so many stories and testimonies of people that survived that attack, or those that lost loved ones, and we hear their stories, it just reminds us that life is very precious, and that we're here for a purpose, and that we look at all these other people in the world who aren't living for Christ, and we see the impact that their sin has on so many people. There's not a person who was alive that day on 9/11/2001 that wasn't affected because of the sins of humans that did not have their life focused on Christ. And so it's a reminder to me to follow Jesus and to witness to other people, to follow through with the Great Commandment, to share the love of Christ with others, because love would never have led to this event. This was really about evil. And so it really has, I believe, strengthened my faith and is a reminder to me to share the love of Jesus with other people.
The main thing is prayer and to be there for them when events like this take place, or we have events, you know, here locally that also impact the local first responders. What a friend we
have in Jesus. And I know that Northgate in particular, from, you know, the preacher on down, is very supportive of, you know, all the people that serve in the military. We have a couple people in our congregation that do so. And just the continued support, continue what they're doing, and, the continued prayers.
I think
that care packages, which is light of the day, and make every, and they would know that they were serving a good cause, to get, they were serving their country in the most amazing way they could.
Any first responders are very, we're very close-knit family. When you get down to the brass tacks, we all know the baseline is that we do what we do because we love what we do, and we love people. We love trying to help people. And most of the time, first responders, law enforcement, paramedics, firefighters, we build a wall up around us so that way we can protect ourselves from what we see, what we do, try to protect our families from that part of our jobs. And normally we don't seek help. I mean, you know, normally we don't go out and try to seek for someone to help us, because we are the ones that help others. I think that a church that stands behind and notifies and is known to be a lover and a provider and support for any first responder or any law enforcement, any firefighter or paramedic, that sets not only the church apart, but the people in that church.
Son, you work on earth this day. Thank you, Dan. Let me ask, we recognized our military earlier in the service. If you are a first responder, would you just please stand up where you are and let us thank you today? You're a first responder, and you're with us. Thank you. We invite you to open your Bibles to the book of Nahum. We've heard this text already read in our service this morning. Nahum chapter 1. If you're having a difficult time, go to Matthew and turn left. If you get to the Psalms, you've gone too far. It's between Micah and Habakkuk. Nahum chapter 1, and we're going to look at those two verses along with some other scripture. Let's pray together. Oh, Father, we come before you this day in the name of Jesus. And we thank you, Lord, for your grace, your amazing grace. You are our provider. We ask, God, that you would bless reading and the preaching and the hearing of your perfect word. And we ask in the name of Jesus, amen. On September the 16th, 2001, I stood in a pulpit just like this one and tried to comfort a congregation just like you of shocked, overwhelmed, and frankly, very, very angry. And what I want to share with you this morning is nearly verbatim what I shared 10 years ago today. On September 17th, 1862, 149 years ago from next Monday, a week from tomorrow, about 5,000 Americans lost their lives at a place called Sharpsburg, Maryland, the Civil War Battle of Antietam Creek. That day historically has been known as the bloodiest day on American soil. More Americans died on American soil on that day than any other day in our history. Now, especially 10 years ago, that day seemed to have been eclipsed. Because on the Sunday following 9/11, we didn't know how many had died. Thousands were still missing. Some estimates were that perhaps as many as 20,000 had lost their lives. Our nation was changed in an hour's time. The events of that fateful Tuesday still ring fresh in our minds. We were experiencing a variety of emotions, immensely distressed, overwhelmed, and angry. We wanted justice, and we wanted justice immediately. But as Christians, as hard as it is to do, when we face injustice, when we face evil, we must submit our emotions and our intellect and our traditions to the Word of God. We had to 10 years ago, and we have to today. So what does the Bible say about how we should handle injustice when it comes into our lives? How do we respond to a situation like we experienced 10 years ago? I believe we'll find some answers in the Word this morning. First of all, we live in a world of hate. Nahum 1, verses 7 and 8. The Lord is good, a stronghold in the day of trouble. And He knows those who trust in Him. But with an overflowing flood, He will make an utter end of its place, and darkness will pursue His enemies. The book of Nahum is about a city named Nineveh. More specifically, it's about God's judgment upon that city. Nineveh was the capital of Assyria. Assyria was a nation that hated Israel. In fact, it was the Assyrians that defeated Israel, the northern kingdom, in 612 BC. You see, hate is the fuel of war. It's been said that war is the playground of Satan. I think that's true. That's what happened on September 11, 2001. We saw hate on American soil. We saw the very face of hate. Oh, we've seen war before. We're very acquainted with war. As I shared earlier, nearly 5,000 Americans died at Antietam on September 17, 1862. We saw war and death at Pearl Harbor, December 7, 1941. We saw war and death at the beaches of Normandy, D-Day, June 6, 1944. We saw war and death in Korea and in Vietnam. We saw it on September 11th. We see it in Afghanistan and Iraq even today. But I want to suggest to you this morning that what we saw, what happened 10 years ago today, is very different. In fact, unique in the history of our nation. Different in that at Antietam, there was a battlefield where brave soldiers fought brave soldiers in what each considered to be a just war. Different in that at Pearl Harbor, there was a military base where brave troops attacked brave troops who had enlisted in the military knowing the inherent dangers of military service. Different in that on D-Day, brave troops assaulted a beach defended by brave troops. What we saw on September 11th were not casualties of war. What we saw on September 11th was mass murder. Murder. The murder of people who were not soldiers. The murder of people who were not warriors. The murder of people who were simply going about their daily lives. We saw the murder of the innocent. Innocent men and innocent women. We live in a world of hate, and hate showed its face on that day in America in a way that we have never seen before and we will never forget. The normal reaction to that kind of brutality is sadness and anger. What I was trying to do on that Sunday morning 10 years ago today, what I'm trying to do this morning is to help us to get honest. Honest with God and honest with ourselves. You see, before there can be healing, there first has to be honesty. That's why we have to admit that we're sinners before we can be saved. We have to confess our feelings to God, and we were sad and we were angry and we wanted justice and we wanted justice immediately. But secondly, there's a commandment to keep. A commandment to keep. Matthew 5, 43 and 44. These are the words of Jesus. The Bible says, you have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies. Bless those who curse you. Do good to those who hate you. And pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you. We were angry. Many of us still are. And we had a righteous anger. That is, we had a legitimate right to be angry. We wanted justice. And we had a cause. But as Christians, we have to submit ourselves, our emotions, our intellect, our traditions, all of who we are and all of what we have to the authority of the Word of God. Jesus said in Matthew 5:44, "But I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you." When Matthew wrote those verbs, the words of Jesus, love, bless, do good, and pray, he recorded them in the imperative mood. That is, he conveyed to us that Christ commands us to love, bless, do good, and to pray for our enemies. It may not make sense to us. It certainly isn't easy. But it's the Word. It's the Word. God commands us to love our enemies, to pray for them. And even though our emotions, especially 10 years ago, were clearly strained, even though we had a just cause for anger, even war, Scripture commands us to submit all of that to Scripture. So how should a Christian respond? Some Christians, even whole denominations, have historically responded to acts of war by being passive. And they base their pacifism upon scriptures like Matthew 5:44 and other passages like it. But how should we respond to the events of September 11th, 2001? What should we do? Maybe a better question is, what can we do? You remember how helpless you felt? I felt helpless. What can I do? That leads us thirdly to a Christian response. A Christian should respond to any situation, any circumstance, by obediently following Scripture. That's how a Christian responds to any event in our lives. And that requires a thorough search of the Word of God. And as we search, we find many passages that relate in one way or another to a Christian's response to evil and injustice in our world. As I was struggling with all of this, as you were, as I was preparing for this message, God led me to Romans chapter 12, beginning in verse 17, continuing through verse chapter 13 and verse 7. Paul wrote, "Repay no one evil for evil. Have regard for good things in the sight of all men. If it is possible, as much as depends on you, live peaceably with all men. Beloved, do not avenge yourselves, but rather give place to wrath. For it is written, 'Vengeance is mine, I will repay,' says the Lord. Therefore, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him a drink. For in doing so, you will heap coals of fire on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Let every soul be subject to the governing authorities. For there is no authority except from God, and the authorities that exist are appointed by God. Therefore, whoever resists the authority resists the ordinance of God. And those who resist will bring judgment on themselves. For rulers are not a terror to good works, but to evil. Do you want to be unafraid of the authority? Do what is good, and you will have praise from the same. For he is God's minister to you for good. For if you do evil, be afraid. For he does not bear the sword in vain, for he is God's minister and avenger to execute wrath on him who practices evil. Therefore, you must be subject not only because of wrath, but also for conscience' sake. For because of this, you also pay taxes. For they are God's ministers attending continually to this very thing. Render, therefore, to all their due, taxes to whom taxes are due, custom to whom customs, fear to whom fear, honor to whom honor. The question we were asking 10 years ago, the question we're asking even today is, what do we do in the wake of such a tragedy? What can we do? We do the same thing that our parents did and that their parents did and that their parents' parents did. We do what the Bible teaches. We obey Scripture. When our world is turned upside down, we listen to Scripture. When our world is turned right side up, we listen to Scripture. We support our government. We support our leaders. We support our troops. We support our nation. Whether we voted for President Bush or not, whether we voted for President Obama or not, whether we agree with these men or not, whether we like these men or not, whether we believe that we have a just cause for war or not, according to Romans 13, Christians must support their leaders and pray for them. In fact, as we saw in Matthew 5, the Bible doesn't just suggest this, the Bible commands it. The phrase, be subject to the governing authorities, in Romans 13 and verse 1 is written again in the imperative mood. It's not a suggestion, it's a commandment. And that tone, that is the use of the imperative, continues throughout the passage. God commands us to submit to and to honor our leaders. How do we do that? We support. We do what they ask of us. President Kennedy once said, ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country. Those are very profound words. We remember them. On September 11, 2001, we didn't have to ask, because President Bush let us know. He told us what to do. He asked us to pray. And we must pray. Pray for our president. Pray for victims and their families, for rescue workers, for our troops, for our enemies. Pray for wisdom. Pray for discernment. Pray for direction. I don't know about you, but I couldn't sleep the nights following September 11th. My story is I'd been up all night working on schoolwork. Didn't even go to sleep. And was still working in the morning when Tina called and said, a plane has flown into the building. I didn't sleep much that day. I didn't sleep much in the nights to follow. One night, late night, it was 2 o'clock in the morning. I couldn't sleep. And I just began to pray, and I prayed, and I prayed, and I wept, and I wept, and I prayed. And I prayed for the president, that God would grant him rest so that he could make the decisions that he would have to make. Because the decisions President Bush made in the wake of September 11th affected our lives, and even the lives of our children, and even the lives of our children's children and their children. We must pray for our president, whether it be 2001 or 2011 or 2021. We pray for our leaders because the Bible commands it. 1 Timothy 2, 1 through 3. First of all, I ask that you pray for everyone. Ask God to help and bless them all. And tell God how thankful you are for each of them. Pray for kings and others in power. so that we may live quiet and peaceful lives as we worship and honor God. This kind of prayer is good, and it pleases God, our Savior. You know, when our church was praying, you know, when you were praying during the North Gate week of prayer a couple of weeks ago, you remember that at the end of August? Some of you are still praying with the same kind of fervency. I want you to know, I want you to hear me. I want you to know I could feel it. I could tell it. When people are praying for you, you can tell it. President Bush could feel our prayers in the wake of 2001, 9/11. He said so. President Obama can tell the difference. Pray for our president because prayer is powerful. James 5 and verse 16 says the effective fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. I'm going to tell you a little story about prayer, the power of prayer that Tina and I, we had forgotten about it, honestly. During the week of prayer, God brought it to our minds. We began to talk about it. We've talked about it much since then. We were visiting my parents one time, and they lived on a lake on the Alabama-Georgia border, Lake Wise. We'd been on a boat ride, and we came back to the dock, and it was covered. The boathouse was covered, and it was sort of dark in the shadow there. And we're not really sure what happened. We're not even sure who all was there. We know it was me and Tina and my father. We're pretty sure our children were there with us. As my dad was getting out of the boat onto the dock, he dropped his keys into the water. The water was about 12 feet deep. We used to throw Christmas trees and brush into the water there to make cover for fish, to make fishing better. And he dropped his keys. It was a bloop. You know that sound. And my dad said, "They're gone." I thought to myself, "Yep, they're gone." Tina said, "No, they're not. God knows where those keys are. God knows everything." She said, "We need to pray. Ask God to show us those keys, give those keys back to us. We need those keys." We joined hands, whoever was there, we joined hands and we began to pray. I don't even remember who was praying. We began to pray and, "Lord, we need those keys and you know that. Would you please provide the keys for us?" We finished praying and we all went and got fishing poles. On the fishing poles were treble hooks. You know what a treble hook is? It's a hook that has three hooks. We got fishing poles and we dropped those fishing poles with those treble hooks down into the water, 12 feet of water, to get the keys that were on the bottom of the lake. And we didn't drop the line for an hour. We didn't do that for 30 minutes. We didn't do that for 10 minutes. We didn't do that for 5 minutes. On about the third try, one of us reeled up our fishing pole, and there were those keys on that treble hook. That happened as sure as I'm standing here, didn't it, Tina? What I'm telling you is prayer is real. And it's real powerful. And our prayers will not only strengthen our president, they will strengthen us. We'll only know the power of prayer once we get to heaven, and we'll wish we'd have spent more time in it. Because it's powerful. It's life-changing. Prayer draws us closer to God. James 4, verses 7 and 8 says, "Therefore, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and God will draw near to you." Sometimes we find precious stones in some of the most unlikely of places. As a result of the 9/11 tragedy, we had the opportunity as individuals, as churches, as a nation to draw near to God. If we draw near to God, God will draw near to us. Yes, our church or our nation needs better airport security. Yes, we need better intelligent gathering. Yes, we need more help from our allies. But more than anything else, we need to get back to the God who established us as a nation. More than anything else, we need to surrender ourselves to the God who made us to be free. 2 Chronicles 7:14, you're familiar with the verse. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. We were sad 10 years ago. Many of us still are. We were angry 10 years ago. Some of us still are. We wanted justice. 10 years later, we still do. Isn't it interesting how when Saddam Hussein and his sons were captured and executed, it didn't satisfy us. When Osama bin Laden was caught and executed last May, we're still sad. God says, vengeance is mine. I will repay. Nahum says, the Lord is good, a stronghold in the day of trouble, and He knows those who trust in Him. But with an overflowing flood, He will make an utter end of its place, and darkness will pursue His enemies. What should we do? What can we do? We do what the President asked us to do. And on September 11th, 2001, He asked us to pray. The Bible commands we pray for our leaders, even our enemies. Let's pray now. Father, we come before You thankful for Your grace, for Your sovereignty, thankful for the power of prayer. And Father, we pray for President Obama this morning, His cabinet. We pray for all of Congress. We pray for our military leaders here and those stationed overseas. We pray for all of our troops. We pray for all of our first responders. We pray Your hand of protection upon them. We pray for wisdom. Lord, that by Your providence, You would lead them to make righteous decisions. Father, we love You. We submit all that we are and all that we have. All of our emotions, all of our intellect, all of our traditions, to the authority, the Word of God. We pray, God, that through us, You would receive glory. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. If there's never been a time in your life when you've prayed to receive Jesus Christ as your personal Savior and Lord, that's the single most important decision you can ever possibly make. If you've never made that decision, please do that today. Please. Maybe you are a Christian. God is calling you to rededicate your life to Him. Maybe God's calling you to rededicate your prayer life. Maybe God's calling you to come to this altar and spend some time praying today, here, now. You feel free to come. Maybe God is calling you to join this church. Help us to be the hands and the feet of Christ to this community. However God is calling, we simply need to be obedient. We need to do what God calls us
to do. So why don't you come as God calls. Richard, can you come and lead us, please?